It's actually a cell phone commercial, so that's that have been around a little bit. But I just love that that natural sound of creation. Well, welcome to worship for those who are tuning in online. Hope that you feel part of our connection, our worship here as well. Most everything will be showing up on the screens. Again, we'll share Holy Communion today for those who are communing at home. Invite you to gather together, bread and wine, or whatever form that takes in your home, or we have some prepackaged ones if you want some to be able to take and use at home. You're welcome to stop by church and pick up some of those as well. Unfortunately, our COVID rate is still, it's at the highest point it's ever been for Pierce County. It's just not encouraging at all. The Wisconsin trends are starting to trend back down. It went from like a high of about 29% infection rate down to 26. So at least it started, for the state, it started to reverse. For the county, we're still as high as it's ever been. So again, for those who are comfortable being here, we welcome you, glad you're here. But for those who just want to wait it out, I understand completely. Worship from home, as long as that's the most comfortable way for you to be able to do that. So while we're here, we'll minimize our physical touch as much as we can. So there's a sanitizer out there. I encourage you to use that coming and going or whatever. We'll not be passing our offering plates and be creative for passing the feasts. Well, let's take a minute. I'll get our band members back up here. We just want to take a minute just to breathe a little bit in the midst of, it seems every time I turn on the news, it's more just bad news. And so I don't need any more bad news in my life. But as we come today to focus on the gospel, let's take a minute just to center ourselves. I'll put a little music on here just as we breathe. So I invite you, just breathe in. Breathe out. As we breathe in, we breathe in this presence of God, the Spirit that gives life, and exhale all that we need to get rid of, the things that maybe weigh us down, to let go of those. Breathe in life. Let go of everything else. We gather to worship this morning. In the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, lost my pick. Inside the guitar.
I have a spare.
You have an extra one? Thank you. Let's sing Open Our Days. 2, 3, 4. Confess our sins using words from Psalm 32. Blessed are those whose sins are forgiven, whose wrongs are pardoned. Blessed are those when the Lord does not accuse of doing wrong, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. When I did not confess my sins, I was worn out from crying all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as moisture is dried up by summer heat. Then I confessed my sins to you. I did not conceal my wrongdoings. I said, I will confess my sins to the Lord, and you forgave all my sins. Hear the good news. Your sins are forgiven. We hear these words from 1 Peter. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order to proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. There is a Redeemer. 2, 3, 4. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Merciful Lord, you are at once full of mercy and righteousness. May your light shine into our darkness and your Spirit create in us new life. We offer thanks and praise for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Our worship today is sort of a blended style, so we have some of the songs that we typically use at the second service and some from the early. This is one that one of my favorites from our contemporary service, Your Name is Holy. Ready? 2, 3, 4. Thank you. Reading today, Jesus is going to be referencing the book of Numbers, and the setting for this story is the wilderness. Moses had led the people out of Egypt, but the people are complaining and failing to trust God. Reading from the book of Numbers.
From Numbers chapter 21, verses 4 through 9. From Mount Hor, they set out by the way of the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom. But the people became impatient on their way. The people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and we detest this miserable food. Then the Lord sent poisonous serpents among the people, and they bit the people so that many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord to take away the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people, and the Lord said to Moses, "Make a poisonous serpent and set it on a pole, and everyone who is bitten shall look at it and live." So Moses made a serpent of bronze and put it on a pole, and whenever a serpent bit someone, the people would look at the serpent of bronze and live. Here ends the reading.
Sing our Alleluia. I'm going to head over here, Lee, if you're going to follow the camera there. I'm going to start a little video here.
For God so loved the world, all of us, you and me. He loved us so much, he sent his only son, Jesus. The firstborn of creation, sent to take our place, to bear our burden, to suffer our consequence. We were far from God, but God didn't want to be far from us. Jesus came to bring us home. As a prodigal returns to their father, so too could we return to our Creator. A simple plan with just one requirement. Belief. For whosoever believes in him will not perish, but will have life. Life eternal. At the very heart of God is love. Indescribable, unrelenting, unstoppable love. That love shines a light, guiding us home. For God so loved the world.
Probably the most well-known verse of scripture that we have, John 3:16. Maybe too familiar, because I think too often we think we know what it means. So this morning, it's always helpful for me to put scripture in context. And so that's what we will be doing today. The context is John's gospel, the story of Nicodemus. We're introduced to Nicodemus here in chapter 3, and he'll show up again halfway through the gospel and again at the end. There's an interesting TV show right now. It's focused on the life of Jesus. It's called The Chosen. I had a clip from, you maybe saw this clip in the newsletter. At first, I was a little wary of this because of the guy who was producing it. His name is Dallas Jenkins. And his father is the guy who wrote the Left Behind series, you know, which is this fictional account, which in my mind just completely distorts the book of Revelation in very dangerous ways. So I was all prepared to hate this just because of who his dad was. But I watched it anyway because someone told me, oh, you should watch that. And I think they do a very good job of capturing sort of the setting, the spirit of the gospel. So for the most part, I've been very, very pleased with it. They work hard at bringing these biblical characters to life. And so you get all kinds of backstory and stuff that's not in the Bible, but creative imagination to create a setting where something like this could be happening. So in the first season, probably the main character other than Jesus in the story is Nicodemus. His quest for understanding who this Jesus is. And so if you want to go back to the newsletter, you know, if you want to watch the little clip, I think it's worth some time to do that. Again, in the Gospel of John, though, it's chock full, as I mentioned the last couple of weeks, full of symbolism and signs, and so we look for those. John always plays the story with these very complex chords that are going to resonate through images that come from the scriptures that he brings into the future. But the response most often is that people then misunderstand the symbolic language and take it literally. And then John has to come back again and then unpack it a little bit for us. So that's what we find again here in our reading today. It's from John 3. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night. He said to him, Rabbi, we know you're a teacher who's come from God, for no one can do the signs you do apart from the presence of God. Jesus answered him, Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. Nicodemus said to him, Well, how can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and of spirit. What is born of flesh is flesh. What's born of spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I say to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses. You hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who's born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you don't understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. So indeed, whoever believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." Let's unpack that a little bit. We're told that Nicodemus comes to Jesus at night, and I don't think that's any accident. This light and darkness is huge in the Gospel of John as a theme of how the story unfolds. It goes back to the prologue, right, where the darkness was opposed to the light and the world does not recognize Jesus who comes as the light. Apparently, Nicodemus has been following or paying attention for a while because he tells Jesus he's seen the signs that Jesus has done, and he knows that they point to God. But he's trying to understand what exactly that means. So he's come. He wants to see for himself. And Jesus says this about seeing. He says, "No one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Or some translations say being born again. Again, that throws Nicodemus, who isn't thinking symbolically, but this idea of a fresh start, of beginning your life again, is a powerful one. In small ways, we do that like when we make New Year's resolutions, right? This year's going to be different, all right? I'm just going to change things here. Growing up as a pastor's kid, sometimes it was pigeonholed. People would make assumptions about you. So in 1972, when I graduated, I was really excited to get out of town, right? To go someplace where nobody knew my name. And so I went to college about 500 miles away, where I would have a chance to reinvent myself. I could be whoever I wanted to be was what I told myself anyway. And that fall of 72, my anthem, my theme song, hit the charts. Now, I already was a big John Denver fan, but Rocky Mountain High came out that fall. And I remember these words. It was so powerful, thinking about starting your life again. That starts out with saying, "He was born in the summer of his 27th year, coming home to a place he'd never been before. He left yesterday behind him. You might say he was born again. You might say he found a key for every door." Now, John Denver was talking about being out in the mountains and seeing the Perseid meteor shower, which changed his life and turned it around and gave him a new perspective on life. But for me, I mean, it was this sense of saying, who am I? Who do I want to be? Or how can I do that? Now, over the course of time, I realized who I was, I carried with me wherever I happened to be geographically. But during those years, I found my faith journey reinvigorated, where I had the opportunity to enter into worship, not just because mom and dad were expecting me to show up. I had to figure out, is this something that I wanted to do? And to do something because it was life-giving for me. In many ways, it was a way of beginning a new life. Now, we're not told how Nicodemus responds. Right? He just edges back into the darkness and doesn't emerge again until sometime later. And it's not until after the death of Jesus that Nicodemus really takes his newfound faith public. It's a good reminder that sometimes faith grows slowly. There's some people who have a date and a time that they can pinpoint and say, this is when everything changed for me. For many others, though, who have, like me, who have grown up in faith, I've never not known faith in my life. There's just been these opportunities where I've been able to grow deeper. And for some, that is a process that may take a lifetime or many years. For others, maybe it is a single point of clarity. But I don't believe that faith is a once and done kind of thing. It's something that we live into. It's always an ongoing, changing, growing relationship, mysterious as the wind, the image that Jesus used of Nicodemus, where we can feel its power even without seeing it. Now, Jesus is pretty hard on Nicodemus, as he is throughout the gospel with the religious leaders. He said they're the ones who, if anyone should get it, it's them, right? They know the scriptures inside and out. So Jesus uses this image that the religious leaders would have been very familiar with, the story of Moses raising up the serpent. Now, for many of us, it may not be a story that is right on the tip of our tongues that we know, but it's goes back again to this time when they were in the wilderness, complaining God sends the poisonous snakes. People start dying, and they repent, and Moses makes this bronze stake and puts it up on a pole, and those who looked at it were healed. Again, we read from the gospel, just as Moses lifted up the serpent of the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. So we have this really sort of bizarre image of that which caused the death to also be the means by which they would be saved. And what Jesus does with this is to say he's talking about the cross, right? All right, that leads into this line that we know so well, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. Whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Again, we're still in the opening pages of the gospel, and already, here, right in the beginning of chapter 3, John has already brought the cross into the story. Our other gospel writers will get there eventually as it unfolds, as they tell the story. We start hearing and we experience the cross, but John brings it right to the very beginning of his gospel, front and center. He says, this is what it's about. When John is talking about the world, he's talking about those that don't recognize Jesus. God so loved those that didn't even acknowledge him that he sent Jesus. This is a God that's come with open arms, inclusive to everyone. Verse 17, indeed, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. The cross is not just an unforeseen or unfortunate circumstance. This cross is where we meet God. This is where God meets us. This is what it was about. This is at our most vulnerable point. In the story of the wilderness, the people found healing not because they tried harder to be good, but as they looked upon the serpent that was lifted up. Likewise, our salvation is not the result of renewed effort on our part to be better, but by recognizing, by gazing upon this transforming power of God to shape our lives. Well, John continues. He goes into this light and darkness stuff again. He says, those who believe in him are not condemned. But those who do not believe are condemned already because they've not believed in the only Son of God. This is the judgment. Light has come into the world. But people love the darkness rather than the light because their deeds are evil. For all who do evil hate the light, do not come to the light, so their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so it may be clearly seen their deeds have been done in God. So Jesus is saying here, he says, I have not come to condemn. There's no need for Jesus to condemn. Condemnation was already there, right? We know the brokenness of our world. What Jesus comes to say is, I offer a way out of condemnation. a way out of darkness. I come as a light in the midst of darkness. Jesus, in many ways, creates a crisis, right? That's literally what the Greek word is, crisis, right? And it gets translated here, though, as judgment. There's a choice to be made. Do we choose the light or we choose the darkness? Now, in the reading in English, we sort of miss, there's a transition that happens here. That's because, fortunately, in English, the word you can be either singular you as an individual, or it can be plural for all of us. It's the exact same word in English, but it isn't in the Greek. So when we look at the story in Greek, we see that when Jesus starts talking to Nicodemus, it's the you he uses is singular. He's talking just to Nicodemus. But halfway through the story, the audience is no longer Nicodemus. It's for anyone who has ears to hear. The you becomes plural. The invitation to abundant eternal life is not just to Nicodemus. It's for all of us, for the light shines in the darkness. Well, we want to sing a song that really talks about this new creation, this new life. We may get our band back up here. The song was written by a guy named John Ylvisaker. Talk about a prolific writer. Literally hundreds of songs. And back in the 70s, he was the guy, all right, that was starting to say, how can we sing a new song, maybe, and find some other ways. So this is In Christ a New Creation. I mean, the language, some of it comes from Paul's letter, but it really talks, in my mind, what it means as we talk about being born again. Ready? One, two, three.
In Christ a new creation, in Christ we are made new, in Christ the Lord of nations is calling me and you. In Christ a new creation is rising from the old. Let's start the celebration and let our lives unfold. In Christ a new creation, in Christ we are made new. Reconciliation at last is coming true. In Christ a new creation, ambassadors are we. Go out to every nation and set the captives free. In Christ a new creation, in Christ we are made new. We feel the liberation, we feel God's promise too. In Christ a new creation, reborn to live again. We sing for our salvation, we sing the great Amen.
We've been sitting for a while. I invite you to rise as we confess our faith using words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He's seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, life everlasting. Amen. Peace of the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And also with you.
I invite you to share a sign of peace with those around you. You may be seated. Typically at this time we would be passing an offering plate, but with our protocols we aren't doing that. Most of you give electronically anyway. If you did bring a gift, there is a plate in the back, or if you're at home, just drop it in the mail, and we're glad to receive your gift. Let's offer just a word of thanks for the many ways God has blessed us. Lord God, we do give you thanks. You've blessed us in so many ways. Our offering today is simply a token, simply returning a portion which you have first given us. We pray, Lord, that you'd use it then for the work of your kingdom and for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us pray for the church and the whole world and all those in need. Lord, we bring our doubts, our questions, our confusions before you, knowing that nothing is foolish or unworthy of your time. Give us faith to trust in your counsel, to learn from the messengers that you have sent through the ages. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We are indeed fearfully and wonderfully made, along with all of your creation. Open our eyes to the wonders of this world. Humble us to be taught by nature, that we might learn respect and responsibility. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. So often the darkness suits us better than the light, because in the darkness we can hide. Bring us into the open, where forgiveness is real, where redemption is there for the cleansing of our souls. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You give us daily chances to be reborn in you. Bless our lives and our loved ones with your healing presence, especially those who we name before you in our hearts, those in need of healing of mind and body and spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We are by no means the first to question or to wonder or to misunderstand. Generations have done so before us, but yet have found their peace in you. Join us with the saints of every age in your eternal communion, where light shines perpetually. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear our prayers, O Lord, make of us the very answers we seek, to be light for the world and hope for your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We gather now around our Lord's table, and we tell again the story of God's great love, a love shown to us in Jesus. And we tell how Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. He gave thanks. He broke it. He gave it to his disciples. He said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Same way he took the cup. Again, he gave thanks. He said, "Drink of this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant, my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We do have both wine and grape juice available. The wine is a dark color around the outside, and the juice is the inner ring a little lighter colored. There's a regular bread as well as a gluten-free. As soon as we're prepared, we'll invite you come to share in this meal. For those of you who are communing at home, hear these words: the body of Christ is given for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. Given for you. body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen us and keep us in his grace, now and always. Amen. Just a couple announcements here. Our giving statements were emailed out. So if we had an email address for you, it was emailed out in the middle of the week. So check your email, or if it's not used to getting an email from us, might be in the spam folder, so double check that as well. If you prefer to have a written copy, if that's just easier for you, just call the church office. We'd be glad to print you off a printed one as well. I was looking back as we were preparing for our anniversary and found a newspaper article about our annual meeting in 1984. Right, and so it was the article talked about how our congregational president, Ron Stanky, was welcoming Al Nelson, the new property chairman of property and grounds. It said St. Joe's had lent us tables and a projector and screen to be able to make our meeting a success. So that was annual meeting in 1984. I didn't recognize either of them in the picture. All right, Ron Stanky and L. Nelson. All right, our meeting this year is going to be a hybrid meeting. For those who are comfortable meeting in person, we will meet right in here on February 6th at 11 o'clock. It'll be a hybrid meeting, though, so if you're not comfortable being here in person, we've got a Zoom link. We sent it out in the newsletter, and we'll send it by Facebook, and it'll be available on our webpage as well. So if you want to be able to tune in from home, that's what everything was online last year. So this year, hopefully, we're within a couple of weeks, this infection rate will continue a downward trend, and we may be for comfortable gathering. We're not having a Wednesday night meal this week, but Kelly is planning on starting up again in February. So she'll need some help, just because her arm will still be broken. But she's there, willing to give directions and point and say, do this, do that. And so I think we're, and for those who maybe are still not comfortable coming out to eat, you can call, and we'd be glad to get carry-out meals prepared for you. If you miss Kelly's cooking, she's really anxious to get cooking again. And so you can order a carry-out if you want to eat at home, or if you want to venture out. It's a big enough space. I think we can spread out and be able to do that easily. We are printing a new directory, so again, I encourage you, if you've got a family picture you want to update, especially if you've got kids, they change all the time, send that to us. Again, we'll always have an electronic directory. If you're ever wanting someone's email or address, it's right on it's on the internet, it's on our webpage. You can go there at any time to get that kind of information. It is password protected, so if you don't know what the password is, just call the church office. We're glad to share that with you, so we have access to be able to contact each other. We don't have muffins today, but we do have donut holes, so hopefully you don't have to rush off right away. There's donut holes and coffee. We do have our first communion class, again, following worship. We had three of our young people last week joined us for first communion class. We've got three more today who are going to be joining us in our first communion class, and so keep these families in your thoughts and prayers as well. Any other announcements we need to make? All right, let's get our band back up. Let's do our closing hymn. Let's rise if you are able. Good song for Epiphany. Shine, Jesus, shine. Good. We're all in the same key. Two, three, four. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Lord, and let there be light. Peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Shine, Jesus, shine.